And Mr. Hanish is basically an engineer, a multifaceted personality, I should say, settled in Bangalore. He is an educationist again, and however his passions go around nature. He is an avid butterfly lepidopterist, I should say, than a butterfly photographer. His knowledge on host plants and the early cycle life cycles, and now his knowledge on moths are tremendous. I should say one of the personality in South who should be really followed is Mr. Hanish, and comes from a humble background, married and got two children. He teaches in a college in Bangalore, and he gets himself involved in most of the citizen science efforts, and that is how we thought we should give him an opportunity to take this to the lowest level. And people like us, we should definitely be aware of how we can contribute to science. That is what this is about, is being not a scientist, how you can contribute to science. Over to you, Mr. Hanish. I will not take much of your time.
Thank you. Okay. So thank you for the nice introduction. So I'll be talking on something on the citizen science today. So basically, it's quite simple. So you all are the naturalist, so you all are going out, you all are taking a lot of beautiful pictures, and especially being in the one of the biodiversity hotspots, you have the more opportunity to see the things very closely, to record them. So now I'll be talking on how we can convert this into a better data, or a better in scientific research data. So that will be talking. So I'll just switch on my presentation. So I just put it as how I can contribute to science as a citizen. So I mean, the you'd have listened the Manoj sir's previous session. So the famous the naturalist in the Nilgiris from the British era, they were not actually the experts in the area. So they all were passionate about the nature, and they have done immense contribution to the science. Okay. So even when you are studying the diversity of the biodiversity in Nilgiris, you can see the footprints of all that the amateurs. So they spend their time on their passion, and they are documented it the natural history, and still we are trying to reinvent all that thing. So that is the immense work they have done. So they actually, that is thinking to us towards how we can do our little bit towards the science. Okay. So I mean, we are all passionate about the nature works, so the nature. So and we are actually the passionate. So we are spending a lot of time, spending a lot of money. So we are taking some time from family and going out and seeing the things. So all these efforts, so should be, be converted it slightly towards the science. So how you can build the knowledge, how you can contribute to building the knowledge. So how we can share all this data so that the others will also get benefit out of it. And finally, the species which we are recording, or the geography which we are passionate about, that should get conserved. So how our small steps can contribute into conservation of the species, conservation of the habitat. So that is what we are trying to focus. Okay, so that is what we are calling it is citizen science. So you may not be an expert in the area, you may not be a very good photographer, you may be having a lot of restriction, you may be having only very small camera, you may be having only mobile phone and the poor network connectivity, all that things. But still, with all these constraints, you can contribute a lot of things. Okay. So you may not be a the having very good photograph of the species, but still you can contribute to all that. Okay. So this is a Nilgiri group. So you're the blessed with a beautiful geography. So you have it's a the International Bio Reserve and a World Heritage Site by UNESCO. And I know you all are proud of being in Nilgiris or in the surrounding areas. So the weather, the diversity, all that things are actually a really great thing to be there in Nilgiris. So when you're talking about the Nilgiri, so you can see in the Nilgiri there are a lot of the connected reserves are there, the wildlife sanctuaries are there. So it's not an isolated place. So when it is connected to a lot of other national parks, you can see the Bandipur, the Mukherjee, the Kollagal up to the eastern side, we have few national parks. So it is all these are basically connected, and through our the efforts we could conserve most of these areas. So through the our efforts after the independence, so it's a bigger area. So that impact also will be having on the Nilgiri. So the things will be in much better situation compared to the other part of the world. And now you have the responsibility to conserve this particular. In particular area, so you have to look into in your limited space and limited capability, you should also try to do something positive to help the and conserve the nature. So this is a special place, Nilgiri. So talking the entire Nilgiri biosphere, so in lot of endemics. So be it mammals, birds, or the reptiles, or the flora and fauna. So you have the lot of organisms named with the Nilgiri tag. So Nilgiri tar, Nilgiri flycatcher, Nilgiri whistling thrush, so the Nilgiri langurs, so Nilgiri tigers, the butterflies. So lot of endemics. So and nowhere else you can see all these things. Okay. Now there is some gap between the documentation of all these species and the what are the data available in the public space. So usually the data comes out as some scientific research papers, some the consolidated checklist, or some the reviewed these, or some project center. But all these things are limited because you need a lot of time, a lot of efforts to document all that things in proper order. And to do some research, serious research, you have to spend a lot of years. So you have a lot of limitations. Suppose you want to know the status of one particular species. So suppose you're saying some Nilgiri marten. So what is its habitat? What is the behavior of this particular species, and the which are the territory like, so which are the other organism it depends on to stay on or continue. So we have to have more data on all these things, then only we can the positively conserve their habitat and they conserve the particular species. So you need a lot of data to conserve all that thing. So whether you have all the sufficient data on this, okay, so you can also do a bit to help that one here. Okay. So basically we are butterflies, so we'll be taking just an example of the Nilgiri tit. So this is a we can call it's not a very common butterfly, so it's endemic butterfly which can seen only in the in Nilgiris region, so the Chinnar to slightly north. Okay. So this particular butterfly, what is the status of this one? So where if you can see all these things, which are the months it will be available, what are the plants it requires to breed on, and what are the conditions in which they will be flourishing. Okay. Suppose you want to protect this particular butterfly, so what are the things we can do? So then we'll be searching on some literature. Yeah, so we'll be searching on scientific papers. So the in India, nobody's seen its early stages. Okay, so I mean, nobody's seen the early stages means eggs or caterpillar of, or pupa of this butterfly. Nobody's seen. Okay, so what we know, they usually breed on some species of the orchids. Okay. So that we know. And the some of the members here, we have seen them in and photographed them. Okay, in various parts of the Nilgiris, in Chennai, or in the nearby areas. Okay, so the other platform where we can check this one is the, we have now a lot of citizen science initiatives. Okay, the citizen science initiative where the common people have contributed their records. Okay, so that will become a scientific data. Okay, if it is properly vetted and verified, that will become a scientific data. So we have some famous, the there are quite a lot of the citizen science forums now. So one of them is the Global Biodiversity Information Facility. So this is one of the largest database. Okay. Other one is the iNaturalist. Okay. So there also lot of members are there. And recently in India also a lot of people are coming and joining into iNaturalist. They are contributing a lot of records. Okay. And then there are some biodiversity initiatives from India. So I mean, now you have multiple forums to check the what is the status of this the particular species. So the same species which is sitting behind the Manoj sir now. Okay. So the that is a Nilgiri tit. Okay. So the one of the famous citizen science initiatives in India, which we can say it completed 10 years, that is the on the butterflies, that is the iPhone butterflies of .org, that is Indian Foundation for Butterflies. Okay, so they actually, I mean, they verify the features submitted by the various members, so the citizen, and they'll verify it and they'll be documenting it systematically. So it is an open database, anybody can go and see this thing. So when I am checking the Nilgiri tit status, so you can see there are only it is recorded only from 4 or 5 places. Okay, so we have only very limited number of records there. Okay, so in the map you can see which are the places it is reported. So these are reported by the members in that website. Okay, so it is only a handful of them, because even though it is a very popular the butterfly website. Okay, so even lot of the foreigners, lot of the researchers are relying on that records. Okay, and it is a peer reviewed one, so they'll be verifying the records and before uploading there. Okay, so still you have only the records from 5 different places, and I am confident that the lot more people have seen that Nilgiri tit recently, because many passionate members are trying to go there and click them, and many of them members are successful also. But all these records are not reaching into the public space, so some of them may be just sharing over WhatsApp and Facebook. But this WhatsApp and Facebook is not good for the documenting things in a longer time. So because the most of the time the data is incomplete. Okay. So when it is clicked and where it is clicked and the who it is clicked. So it is very difficult to track it. And also the archiving is very poor in the all the social media forums. So actually in this website I just checked the distribution of the species and also the butterfly observation in the month. Okay, suppose I want to see this butterfly, which month, where I have to go, that information we don't know. Okay, you can see it is reported from Kerala and Tamil Nadu, means Kerala, it is in Chennai Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay, so we don't know how it is distributed. So October, some 4 sightings are there. September, some 6 sightings. I think all that are from one single trip. Okay. So we have only some isolated handful of the records. So we don't have a clear picture about how it is distributed, I mean, where it is distributed, and what is the habitat of this one, whether they will be appearing after the rains or before the monsoon. Or so we have only very minor clues now about the distribution. We don't have any complete picture of this one. Okay. So there are a lot of gap in the reporting of this one. So if the members from the Nilgiri, if they are reporting it in their all the records properly, I think at least you should have a very good idea about how, I mean, their breeding behavior, how their sporting behavior. So that is missing now. Okay. So the same species I checked on the iNaturalist. Okay. So iNaturalist for this same species, Hypolacinia nilgirica. So I have seen 3 records there. Okay. So out of these 3 records, actually 2 are from Sri Lanka. Actually, this same species is found also in Sri Lanka. Okay. And there also it is not very common, but there we can see 2 records from there, and one from the Jeevich record is from Kallar. So only 3 records are there. Okay. And if you are looking the seasonality graph, okay, with the 3 records, we don't know, we will not get any idea about the records. Okay. So you need more data to get the more clue on how it is distributed, how we can conserve them, all that. Okay. So the history and life stage is no records yet. Okay. And in GPAF, the biodiversity portal, there is no record of this Nilgiri tit. Okay. So that is the status of one particular key species, endemic species in Nilgiri. So there is a lot of gap between the reporting of this species. Okay. So which is available online, or which is available for the public, and which anybody can verify it. And this is all these forums, actually the people are verifying the records and will be confirming the ID. So these are becoming some research grade data. So this data becomes research grade data. Okay. And this is the Wikipedia page on it. Okay. You can see 2 pictures here in the Wikipedia, but if you look it, both the pictures are from Sri Lanka. Okay. So there are no other pictures from India. So there is a clear gap between the actual the species data in India. So there is a lot of gap. Okay. So that is the area where you can actually contribute. Okay. So you may be presently an enthusiast. Okay. So you are interested in some particular area. Suppose you may be a birder. Okay. You may be a watching butterflies, or you may be interested in mammals. So, but you are going out and taking pictures. So that is, and sometimes you'll be sharing this sighting in some of the social media platforms, or you may be asking for IDs. So you may be trying to click the picture of that. So that is the enthusiast level. But this data, most of the time, it is not reaching into the scientific community, or it is not converting into a knowledge. Okay. So it will be dying at the lower level. So it will be dying at the social media level. So after a few years, you want to search out some record from Facebook, and most of the time it will be very difficult. And most of the time, the data is incomplete. Okay. Now, in the next level, if you are contributing this data into some of the citizen science forums, so we have quite a lot now. So the iPhone butterflies is for the butterflies. So you have the iNaturalist, where it is for the broad spectrum. You can upload anything there. Okay. So even the cultivated ones, even the farm things, everything you can actually contribute there. Okay. So then there are a lot of the experts are there. So once, suppose you can identify some species with some confidence, and you can also suggest this is the species. So that time you are also becoming an expert. And if a few people are, few experts are confirming that ID, it will become in research data. So research data means, so that can be used by the researchers, that can be used, available for the public to see where this species will be there, how is the status, all that things we can know. So you're one feature which may be lying in your system or your hard drive, so will be reaching into the scientific community. So in the long run, it may help that species, or it may help that habitat for conservation. Yeah. So that is what is the citizen scientist can do. Okay. So only these are the things when it's recorded, when you are the converting your picture into data. Okay. So usually, suppose you have clicked some grasshopper in the field. Suppose you are a birder, when you are going in the field, you have seen some grasshopper. So it's a beautiful grasshopper. You don't know what is the identification of that one. But it is a beautiful one. So you just click it and you are uploading it any of this platform. So you have to just address these four questions when you are updating it. Okay. Suppose you don't know what is it. Okay. So you can just leave it. The experts will take care of it. They'll suggest the IDs. So once you are getting the confident ones, they will be automatically updated there. Yeah. So what you are not very much worry about. Okay. But the other things are important. Okay. So where you are clicked. Okay. So there is a small problem with the giving exact location of some of the species. Okay. So that we understand. Suppose some endemic species is found only in a very limited areas in some pockets. Okay. So you need not exactly disclose the exact point. Okay. So you can give the broader area. Suppose you are found in a Nilgiris. Okay. So you found in Kallar. So you can just mention it is Kallar. So you need not specify this which place in Kallar. You can just specify the broader area. So that is the space, but that place is important where you have seen this sighting. Okay. And the date, okay, you have seen that to get the seasonality of the particular species, the month and date is important. So that will be contributing adding value to that one. And finally, who has clicked. So suppose it's your picture, or suppose you are uploading some picture from some museum specimen, so that also you can specify. Yeah. So these are the four questions you have to address when you are uploading something on the platforms. Okay. So this is actually one Nilgiri tiger. This is a butterfly endemic into this region. Okay. So you can see all the data is captured here. Okay. So it's actually Chikmagalur district. Clicked in Kemanagundi. So the date and time, everything is there. So you know the complete picture about this, or you have the complete data about this species. So it is quite simple. You have to just put the species name if you know. Okay. And which place and date. Okay. And the contributor's name. So that much is enough for the uploading the data in all these platforms. Okay. So usually if you are logging with your account, so contributor part, that part will be already attended addressed. Okay. If you don't know the exact species name, so that the experts will take care. So don't worry about it. So only the pending details are the space and the place and date. Okay. So that is why in most of the social media forums, also most of the groups, when you are posting something, we are insisting to add the place and date. Okay. Because that is important. So to know the distribution of the species, to know the seasonality of the species, that is important. Okay. So you can see that. So don't worry about you're focused only in birds or only in plants or only in some spiders, all that thing. Okay. But whenever you are going out in the field, you'll be getting a lot of other things. Okay. So you'll be clicking a lot of other interesting stuff in the field. And all that things you can contribute into the citizen science forums. Okay. So a lot of bees, the bugs, the plants, the mushrooms. So all that thing. Okay. So actually, I'll be stopping the presentation with here. So I'll be showing how we can contribute into the any of these forums. Okay, I'll just go to the So this is the one of the platform. It is visible, no? So
yeah, it is
inaturalist.org. Okay. So I mean the one big advantage of this one is okay. So now you have the mobile apps also available for this one. Okay. So you can even click your pictures on mobile, and whenever you can free, you can just upload from the mobile app. Okay. So that's a easier thing. Okay. So you can just download the app from the Play Store, and you can keep in your phone, or I mean also the desktop application, which is I am using now. You have to just create a login, and you can just go there. Okay. So I mean, if you're just logging in, okay. So I mean, it will be taking to a page. You can explore a lot of things. Okay, suppose in the explore option, you can select the suppose you want to see some species. Suppose the you are saying the Nilgiri tar. Okay, I'm just clicking one species. You want to just know about the species, you can just go and check the species status. Network is having slight issues. Okay. So Nilgiri tar, you can see a lot of pictures contributed by many people there. Okay, you can see a lot of interesting photographs there. Okay, and the you are just clicking on one species, you'll be getting the information about that species. So I mean, you can see somebody, the person who uploaded it, he was not knowing what is exact species this one. So he was just putting it is in the goats and sheep group. So he was not knowing that what is the exact species of that one. Then the people are suggesting the IDs. Okay. So they'll be just suggesting the ID. And you can also compare whether this is the actual picture, and the suggested species is this one. Okay. Then you can also verify whether it is correct or not. Now, a lot of the AI application also came in. So I can just go to the my page, and I think so I can go to your observations. Okay. I'll just try to add one observation. So I'll just tell how it is easy. I'm just trying to add one picture. So here you can add anything. Okay. I mean, whether it is bird or mammal or plant or picture or something. I'll just add one picture from my, okay. So one dragonfly picture I'll try to add. Okay. So species now, suppose I don't know, this is it is suggesting. See, the AI is suggesting actually which species it may be. So you need not actually, I just try to upload this picture. That time itself, it is suggesting the species. So I just randomly clicked one picture. So you can see which are the pictures. So it will be just checking the visually similar pictures, and it will be suggesting. So I think it's the paddy skimmer. Okay. So the date actually, if you are from the EXIC data, it is actually taking the date. So actually, if the photo is geotagged, then it will be automatically capturing that also. But it is not presently tracked. Actually, this I taken from the Kerala in my native. Yeah. So actually, if you can give the latitude and longitude, if no, so from the phones and all, usually it can take. So I'll just take some. Yeah. So this was my native, the Kerala. So it'll be taking some place there. Yeah. So it is automatically picking the day place there. Yeah. So you need not exactly specify this place if you are, it is a very sensitive species, or if it's a very rare species, you need not exactly specify the exact location. You can have some vague location, this particular area. So then you can exactly pin the location. Suppose you are found it on your home garden, so you can actually pin the location, so later it will be easier for you to update it. So I'm just updating the observation. So I was not knowing the species name, so it suggested some name, so I've taken that one. The date it has taken from the EXIF data, from the picture itself. Yeah. And place I given. So if you want to add some description, suppose how you have found or anything, any additional information if you want to give, then you can give. Otherwise, you can go to the submit. Okay, so my picture is now added here. Yeah, so it is this much simple now. Yeah, now if somebody, some other users, yeah, some of them may be interested in dragonflies, so they'll be looking for this particular dragonflies and all, or some of your friends may be adding it. Okay, so they'll be just adding the IDs here. Suppose they'll be just clicking on the picture and they'll be suggesting some IDs. Okay, you are also aware of that species. You can also go to the area and you can suggest an identification. Okay, or you can make some comment. Okay, suppose somebody else is given some identification, you can compare with that one. Okay, so it is quite easier now. Even the mobile app is available. You can just upload from your phone or your system, all that thing. So it is quite easier. So the iNaturalist is quite easier. So you can basically upload anything there, and it will become a data. So you can see where it is clicked in the map. Okay, which month and date. Okay, so all the details are here. Okay, so it is observed on the September 22nd, 2019, submitted on this date. So all this data is visible now. Okay, so this is how you are converting your data into photo into a data. Okay, now it is quite easier. And the one more one more important thing is, okay, suppose it is very difficult to retrieve your data from your hard disk, because some of the maybe having a lot of data, some of the lot of hard drives, so it is very difficult to retrieve that one. So if you are using this platform, so you can see all your observations are here. Okay, so all the observation I uploaded are here. You can just search it and find it out. Suppose I want to try this paddy skimmer, I can just search it there. Or if you want and don't know the exact species also, you can search it there. So it is easy to retrieve all your pictures, all your data. So it'll be an extended the drive. So if you are having some time if you are having some internet facility, you all should try to convert your data into some of this, some of your record into such data, so that it will be, once they approve the identification, it will be converting into research data. So here I just suggested some data, some name, but it is not converted into the research grade data. So if at least two people agreed on that data, then it will be becoming a research grade data. Okay, so that is how the iNaturalist work. So you have some similar platforms like another one is the Butterflies of India website. Okay, so there you need to create a login. Okay, but it is for only for the butterflies, and they are slightly bothered about the quality of the pitches. Yeah, so they are looking for better pitches and better quality of pitches. Yeah, because it's a peer-reviewed journal, so they'll be looking to that one. Yeah, so all these things are quite easier. So this is how you can contribute into the science, and you can contribute into the conservation of the species. Okay, so now I'll just stop the presentation here. I can take questions, okay, or any other suggestions if you are having, I can take.
Any questions, raise your hand or type in the chat window.
They can also ask if only less number out there, then they can just raise the question. Yeah, you can unmute and ask, no problem.
Yeah, hi Anish. Yeah. Thanks for that. Yeah. Thanks for the chat. Yeah, so that was a very useful sharing of iNaturalist and GBIF and iPhone Butterflies of India. Okay. My question is that also a couple of these. Citizen science initiatives, typically, except for the India Biodiversity Portal, have come out from some of the Western counterparts, right? So, and they've been here for a while, right? We have had iNaturalist for some years now, and the GBIF has been there for quite a bit, and even the India Biodiversity Portal has been on for a long time. So, what do you think? What do you think is hindering people? And my question is, because focus from non-urban, non-metro kind of locations where network access and all these may not be as easy for people, do you think that's a big hindrance for people to get onto these web-based?
Two, three things. Actually, the social media platforms are easier for people because they'll be getting some encouragement from their friends. They'll be getting some happiness in uploading something. Okay, but all the citizens and forums, they may not be getting that much the support directly. Okay, so that is one problem. The another problem is it requires some time to systematically upload the data and all. But in iNaturalist and all, it is easier. Suppose you are just tagged in one location for one trip. Suppose today you are gone out for a trip, and you are getting some 200 pictures, you want to upload some 50 of that one. So with one location, if you are saving it, you can upload all the pictures together. It will not take much time. Okay. So, and another problem was the network connectivity. Actually, we are slowly coming up now. Okay. So in the most of the places, the network is still problem, and it was costly also. Okay, now, but we are slowly coming out of that one. So this is the time we are trying to slowly reaching out the people. Okay, and you have seen few more facilities. The app has come, the mobile app, so which make the people to easily upload the things easily, because you can click from your garden and you can just upload in your platform. Or if you want to know which species it is, you can easily check it out there. And another thing is the AI facilities. You have seen that. So when I just uploaded a dragonfly picture, it was just suggesting that this may be one of these species. So, and if you are having some idea of the organism, then you can actually sort it out. Okay, or some of the other experts can at least come and help you. Okay, so what I see is, okay, so the Butterflies of India website, they are actually in the last 10 years, you can see the lot of contributors, lot of people are coming out and helping it. So it's going in a bigger scale, because now they have lakhs of pitches. Okay. And and especially during this lockdown, lot of data, and they are actually clearing some 10,000, 12,000 pitches per month now. So, and the lot of people are coming out, and we are slowly moving up. Okay, so the iNaturalist and all last 2 years back, the representation from India were very less. But now we are slightly better situation. A lot of people are joining, a lot of records are coming up. Okay, so the Indian biodiversity is slightly picking up in the citizen science way. Okay, so we are seeing a lot of positive things there.
Anish, yeah, thanks. Thanks for that update. Yes, but I think iNatural still lacks Indian data checklist so far as the taxa and subspecies do not get covered adequately, because I am on iNatural, I am on GBIF. So iNaturalist, I think, still lacks not just Indian representation in terms of people putting in, but its backend itself to be able to assess the data and the species and subspecies level. So,
we need more data to get more people coming in. Yeah. So that is why. So if you are having a lot of data, then definitely a lot of people will come up. Okay. Because they can do the research there. Okay. How the distribution, all that, with that data, you can come up. Because if you see it, 2-3 years back, the iNaturalist, the data was adequately, not adequate from India. But now we are slowly picking up. So definitely it will be improving.
Yes, I agree. I think, one other question which I had, if nobody else has one, is how do you think this is catering towards children? Because we're looking at citizen science. When I say children, I don't mean the younger children, but some children who are now tech savvy, who understand, who are in the age group of, say, 10 to 17 or 12 to 18, who are quite able to, who are quite good at observations and all. Do you think all of these apps are a little more catered to an adult mindset in terms of how you upload and all of that, or is it friendly for the adolescent?
First thing is that the very young children, we may not be directly suggest that, but they can actually pick up very fast through this one. Okay, now the mobile apps is a good trend and they are using a lot of AI techniques. So the once you get the response quickly, so your species can be identified immediately, then a lot of people will be definitely coming. A lot of enthusiasts will be definitely coming into such platforms. Okay, so that is the how we are seeing. So especially for the all the beginners, it will be a good thing, and those who are into the any type of nature watching, so birds or butterflies or the mammals, so they can actually, and they'll be having a lot of other pictures, so they can also contribute into it. So they slowly the database build up, so it'll be helping the science.
Thanks, Anish.
Anish, I have a question. I remember last year in the butterfly and the birding circuit, there were some controversies with how data is handled in citizen science websites. I think it was a great bird count or some other.
E-bird.
Okay. Yeah, e-bird, e-bird census or something. I don't remember the exact thing. Yeah. So how do you think ethical issues are handled by iNaturalist, GBF and all that? Say, how do they monitor the data, or how do they share data with the researchers?
Yeah. So actually this is the open platform so for now. So the data is available for everybody. Okay. So the eBird having they're having the some of the data is stored only in the kernel, their own data. It is was stored in the outside India. That was the one reason why the eBird having some issue. So that is why I'm not saying to contribute to only one. So we have a lot of Indian based website now. The iPhone butterfly is a purely Indian one. So the Indian biodiversity portals. So they have also the lot of the website for moths, birds, all that thing. So it's you can also suggest. So we are not recommending that you use this particular one, but it is open for you to select. Suppose you are you want to contribute to only Indian website, then that is fine. That is why we are not suggesting any particular one. I just mentioned that how easy it is to contribute to all these things. Okay. So finally it is your choice where you can contribute and how you can contribute. And we are not saying to contribute everything. So suppose you have a very good photograph or anything. So if some data, if you want to hold on, then that is fine. And also I told the you need not the completely disclose all the critical data like the exact point of some endemic species and all, you can conceal it. So that's always entertained. Any other questions? Manoj, sir, you have?
Nothing. I wanted to only add that that is what you had clarified, Anish, sir. The plagiarism.
No, it is always up to the contributor to decide. So, that's what I'm saying. I'll not recommend anyone, but you can use your own platform. You can select your own one. So, you can continue with your own, because the birds also, Birds of India website has come from the Indian Biodiversity Portal. So they have the cicadas special website, the amphibians separate website. So we are slowly developing our own. So you see, last 10 years, we have the iPhone butterflies, you have seen more than 1,000 species we have recorded. So we have only 1,100 or 200 species maximum we'll be having. So we have almost covered all that thing. Okay. So, and you can see the list of contributors is huge. Okay. It's not the only handful of people. It's really a citizenship initiative. So, and only few researchers cannot contribute that much. That is the point we are stressing.
Thank you, sir.
Anyone else? Manoj, sir, can we call it?
I think
we are well past our time. So I, on behalf of the Winter Blythe Association and NNHS, I thank Mr. Hanish for doing this repeat session for our Nilgiri audience. So thank you so much, sir, and it's been a pleasure interacting with you. And I'm sure many of our people in this meeting will start contributing to citizen science in whatever way they can. Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone. Thank you.
Thanks.